Genetically modified foods have a bad reputation. Companies like Bayer, which sell these seeds, face heavy criticism. But is that really justified? One method in particular has drawn strong resistance, inserting genetic material, a transgene, from one organism into another. For example, a gene that makes a plant resistant to certain insects can be added to its genome, or a gene that allows the plant to tolerate a specific herbicide. These are called genetically modified organisms, GMOs, and they're regulated worldwide.
First of all, there have been fears from day one of the use of GMOs or development of GMOs, and those fears and concerns about health and environmental risks and corporate dominance, they have been deeply entrenched.
That's Martin Keim, a member of Germany's National Academy of Sciences. The idea of inserting a foreign gene into a plant may feel unsettling, but let's look at the numbers. A large meta-study found that crop yields increased by 22% on average. Farmers' profits rose by as much as 68%, while pesticide use dropped by 37%.
You can do insect resistance, you can potentially do drought tolerance, you can do fungal resistance, you can do heat tolerance, you can add vitamins, for instance. So, of course, the impacts will be different depending on what you're doing.
Let's take a look at the wheat variety HB4. What makes it special is its reported drought tolerance. It was developed by the agribusiness Bioceres Crop Solutions in Argentina.
La característica principal es que fue desarrollada en Argentina y que está basada en un gen de girasol, porque el girasol es un cultivo naturalmente resistente, a la, mejor dicho, tolerante, es la palabra correcta, al estrés hídrico.
Under dry conditions, the company says yields could increase 20% on average. HB4 wheat has been on the market since 2022 and is currently improved in Argentina, Brazil, Paraguay, the US and a few other countries.
Y el hecho de que haya llegado a comercializarse me parece muy relevante, ¿no?
This is José Luis Reyes, who works at UNAM's Institute of Biotechnology.
Me parece también sorprendente el hecho de que modificar un solo gen haya logrado tener efectos sobre la resistencia de las plantas a sequía, ¿no? Eso es algo que discutimos mucho entre nosotros, con los estudiantes sobre todo, porque uno no comúnmente no encuentra que haya un solo gen que sea responsable de una característica tan amplia en las plantas.
Still, drought-resistant varieties remain a niche market, in part, experts say, because the approval processes are complex and costly. But we'll come back to that later. It's a different story with other GMOs, at least in North and South America.
Allá en los 90, el primer transgénico se aprobó en el 94 en Estados Unidos y en el 96 en Argentina, así que te da una idea de que fuimos bastante pioneros y en otros países como Brasil u otros países latinoamericanos fueron bastante tardíos. El país no tiene un rechazo hacia los transgénicos.
Today, the United States, Brazil, and Argentina are the three countries that cultivate the most genetically modified crops. They're followed by India, Canada, Paraguay, and China. Let's take a look at the US, where alongside China, the most work is being done on a new form of genetic engineering, genome editing. Better known as molecular scissors, these tools are being used at places like Bayer in St. Louis.
And it's something that has been really revolutionary in agriculture. It's a concept that allows you to go into a plant and really fine-tune a gene.
Scientists say molecular scissors, also called CRISPR-Cas9, is a game changer. It allows the genome to be cut at any chosen spot. A new gene can be inserted, or an existing one can be rewritten. The method is faster and more precise than earlier techniques. At Bayer, for example, researchers have used genome editing to develop a new corn variety that can withstand environmental factors, like strong winds.
We've made it shorter and stronger, which actually helps the corn plant stand up in these winds versus tall corn. So instead of being 2 to 4 meters tall, we're now around 2 meters tall. So it's been a really amazing innovation that's been helping with climate change and helping growers produce more.
Bayer is also working on drought-tolerant corn and new ways to combat pests. But if genetic engineering has so much potential, why does it still have such a bad image?
I mean, when you're looking at who were the first and dominant players developing GMO technologies, it was Monsanto, it was DuPont, it was, Syngenta, Biocrop Science, all those multinationals that are known for producing pesticides.
And they're also among the biggest players in the seed market. In 2015, just six companies dominated the global business for seeds and crop protection products. Together, their revenue was about $61 billion. In the years that followed, three huge mergers reshaped the industry. Dow Chemicals with DuPont, ChemChina with Syngenta, and Bayer with Monsanto. According to the U.S. Department of Agriculture, all of these mergers raised antitrust concerns. Each corporation had to divest some of its assets. We'll return to the issue of corporate market power later. Bayer's acquisition of Monsanto was finalized in 2018. The U.S. seed giant had been a leader in developing genetically modified varieties of corn, soybeans, and cotton since the 1980s. In 1996, Monsanto launched the first herbicide-tolerant soybean. To recap, a gene is inserted that makes the plant tolerant to the toxin. In Monsanto's case, the herbicide was glyphosate, better known by its brand name, Roundup. It's still in the headlines today. In the United States, more than 60,000 lawsuits are pending over possible cancer links to the herbicide glyphosate.
Also Monsanto hat schon einen großen Anteil am schlechten Image der Gentechnik, weil man eben mit Gentechnik nicht gemacht hat, nicht die Resistenz der Pflanzen zu erhöhen, sondern man hat eben sie dafür genutzt, um ein bestimmtes Pflanzenschutzprodukt, das Glyphosat, besser vermarkten zu können.
This is Holger Henjes. He's a farmer in northern Germany and vice president of the German Farmers Association.
Die sollte eigentlich die Erträge verbessern, aber nicht einem multinationalen Konzern seine Pflanzenschutzabsätze sichern.
In other words, Monsanto wasn't just selling herbicide-tolerant seeds, it was also selling the matching herbicide, Roundup. So does that mean genetic engineering itself is to blame?
You can depict it in a way that this is all that GMOs have to offer. And that's obviously not true. Let's ban herbicide tolerance if we want. Let's do it, but let's be serious about some of the other potentials and some of the other much more interesting types of technologies.
Take insect-resistant crops, for instance. Pesticide use dropped by an average of 42%, according to the meta-study. That helps boost yields, since fewer crops are lost to pests. And when yields increase on existing farmland, there's less pressure to clear new land. Higher yields, in turn, can also reduce agricultural emissions. And what about health risks associated with genetic engineering? Opponents still raise that as a major concern.
I like to emphasize there has not been any harm to human health with any genetically engineered product anywhere in the world.
That's Pamela Ronald, a leading plant geneticist who has conducted research at Berkeley, Stanford, and Cornell University.
We've had genetic engineering for over 50 years, and it's been applied in medicine and food, beer making, and every independent scientific organization, including the National Academy of Sciences and the European Food Safety Authority, have all come to the conclusion that the technique of genetic engineering is no more risky than other genetic techniques, such as conventional breeding.
So while there is valid criticism of how some GM crops have been used, as with Monsanto, genetic engineering itself isn't the problem. After all, humans have been reshaping the genetics of crops for centuries, just in different ways. For example, crossing one variety with another can create entirely new traits. Mutagenesis uses radiation or chemicals to alter genetic material and produce new varieties. That's how durum wheat, the wheat used for pasta, was developed. And mutagenesis, crossbreeding, transgenes, and genome editing are all processes that can also occur in nature. But let's return to the power of large corporations and the concentration in the seed market.
Creo que es uno de los puntos principales donde yo no estaría de acuerdo con la comercialización de los cultivos como está en este momento, ¿no? Porque justamente crea dependencia. Son pocas variedades las que estarían creciéndose en el campo, cosa que puede no ser muy bueno. Si tenemos una sola variedad y resulta que una plaga surge, pues entonces todo el cultivo se va a perder, ¿no?
Seed patents are especially controversial. Multinational corporations file them to secure profits. So what should we make of the criticism that just a handful of companies dominate the market?
But the bottom line is, you know, we still have to be paid for our innovation. If we can't be paid for it, we really can't launch it, and we can't come up with new innovation. So there are different IP laws around the world. We have to comply with those. We launch new products as fast as we need them to be launched because of resistance, and we need that protection.
Bayer says that the development and approval for a new variety can take 10 to 15 years. Depending on the product, the process can cost anywhere from $100 to $150 million. Is that why it's mainly the big players who invest in new varieties?
Smaller companies don't really have the money to go through these rigorous regulatory standards. And so that means only the very large companies can pay in very large crops that bring in a lot of money to move forward. So I would like to see the regulations streamlined so that small groups can also be innovative.
So what needs to change in terms of regulation? Let's take a look at Germany and the EU. We've already met Holger Henjes. He's harvesting potatoes. Together with other growers, he farms 700 hectares in northern Germany. As vice president of the German Farmers Association, he pushes for less stringent approval procedures. He's not a fan of patents, but he does support licensing. Companies should earn money for a limited time when their products are used. Without that, he says, the effort wouldn't be worthwhile.
Wir versuchen, dass Deutschland auf europäischer Ebene eine Vermittlerposition einnimmt. Einmal zwischen den Leuten, die Gentechnik ganz ablehnen, und auch zwischen den Leuten, die am besten jede Art von Gentechnik patentieren wollen. Wir wollen da einen gesunden Mittelweg haben, dass wir züchterischen Fortschritt ermöglichen, ihn aber gleichzeitig nicht so über Patentrecht blockieren wiederum.
So far, the EU has approved only one insect-resistant variety of corn, MON 810. But it's only grown in Spain and Portugal. No other EU country has approved it. And what happens in the EU has a global ripple effect, even in countries where regulations are less strict.
Other countries that want to export something to Europe or want to potentially export something to Europe will have to see how is Europe doing in terms of approving those things for import that are GMO. And that is leading countries to no, let's don't move forward with it, because otherwise we're losing our export market to Europe.
The EU is now debating how to change its rules on genome editing. The proposal is to regulate it less strictly than older GMO methods. But public opinion has a strong influence on policy. Surveys show many Europeans remain skeptical. So what role do NGOs play? Take Greenpeace. For decades, the group has campaigned against the approval of golden rice in the Philippines. The project was developed by an international team of researchers.
The idea behind this project was to develop a fortified rice that the farmers could grow that had high levels of vitamin A. You would think that would be something that would be widely embraced, but there's been a lot of misinformation about this project.
In 2016, more than 100 Nobel laureates took a stand. In an open letter, they called on Greenpeace to stop its campaigns against golden rice and genetically modified food, arguing that science had disproved their claims, but without success. Golden rice is only approved in countries like Australia, Canada, and the US, but not in the Philippines, where Greenpeace and local farmers filed yet another lawsuit. Greenpeace has also campaigned against Monsanto's insect-resistant corn in the EU. It's also said to have been active in China.
And in China, European NGOs such as Greenpeace have been extremely successful in creating fears, especially when it comes to rice, in creating fears among consumers and policymakers to say, ah, that's something dangerous.
We asked Greenpeace for their view.
Die Studien, die es aktuell dazu gibt, sind zum Großteil industriefinanziert. Das heißt, da müssen die Ergebnisse sowieso mit Vorsicht betrachtet werden. Und die unabhängigen Studien, die es gibt, deuten aber darauf hin, dass auch dort Umweltrisiken auftreten können. Bei der alten Gentechnik ist ganz klar, die Pflanzen, die schon auf den Äckern sind, ob sie jetzt herbizidtolerant sind oder ein Insektizid produzieren, bergen Risiken für die Umwelt und dürfen von daher nicht in die Umwelt ausgebracht werden.
Just as a reminder,
European Food Safety Authority, which is the highest authority in the EU for evaluating many of these new crops, have come to the same conclusion as our National Academy of Sciences and other major scientific organizations around the world, that these crops pose little risk and huge benefits.
Some NGOs have shifted away from the topic of genetic engineering. Even activists like Mark Linus have changed their position. He was once part of a grassroots movement against genetically modified crops, including work with Greenpeace.
We used to go out and destroy GMO crops at night. We used to tear them up, slash them down, and we managed to destroy all of the outside GM experiments in the United Kingdom at that time. When I realized that scientists were on the other side from the environmental movement on the GMO issue, I realized that that was inconsistent, and that if you're going to support science and ask for people to take scientific evidence seriously, you can't be anti-science on GMOs and pro-science on climate change.
So what's the takeaway? Rather than rejecting genetic engineering outright, we should evaluate it on a case-by-case basis. Some traits have proven beneficial, others have been harmful, but the science is solid. Approving a new crop variety is costly and time-consuming, and processes differ widely around the world. That shuts out the smaller players, leaving power with the big corporations. And yet, with climate change and food security at stake, scientists and farmers say we urgently need these new tools.
Wir brauchen neue Sorten, die so Hitzewellen, wie wir zum Beispiel letzte Woche hatten, besser überstehen. Wenn es mal 35, 36 Grad gibt, dass sie nicht sofort absterben. Und einfach Pflanzen, die auch über ein besseres Wurzelwerk, eine bessere Wassereffizienz haben, dass sie das vorhandene Wasser besser ausnutzen und mehr in Ertrag umsetzen.
What are your thoughts on genetically modified food? We'd love to hear from you in the comments.